that lightly. And in all honesty, we need to protect that. The presence of God is precious. And while we need to practice it, we also need to make sure that we need to protect it. Something that is precious is something that we want to protect. We want to make sure that nothing happens. And to be honest, sad to say, if something went awry in the church, there could come a point where the Holy Ghost no longer dwells here like he does now. And you can walk on the property and no longer feel him like you feel him now. We need to guard that, not just in our church, but we need to begin with our everyday life. It begins with us. When we look at the Word of God, the priests were responsible for maintaining the presence of God in the temple. They were the ones who were responsible for maintaining the lamps, which signified and symbolized the presence of God. They were the ones that trimmed the wicks every day. They were the ones that made sure that the lamps stayed full of oil, that the oil stayed fresh. It didn't get outdated, but that it was fresh. It was their responsibility. And they didn't just keep the presence of God, but they maintained it by trimming those wicks every day, getting the soot off, by taking off the burnt ends. They were keeping it freshly flowing, freshly burning. And it never went out. And if we go a little bit farther in the Word of God and start studying out the tabernacle that everyone loves to study out with the shittim wood and this way to go, and that way to go, and this, and it symbolizes this and this. I know, everyone loves it. But if you study it out, God sent down fire for the first sacrifice. And that fire was to not only be kept and protected, but it had to be maintained. And we find that there were sons of Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, that did not maintain the presence of God or even the symbol of the presence of God. And they let the fire go out. And what happens when the fire goes out? Well, then we got to make new stuff. We have to compensate. We need to get something going here. But God sent down fire from heaven. It was special fire. It was from heaven. It was from God himself. But they let it go out, so they made fire of their own, and God called it strange fire. And because of that, he struck them down. They were not protecting the presence of God. And because of that, God struck them down. They did not do things God's way. And they weren't the only ones that failed to do what they were supposed to do. They were not the only ones that failed to maintain the presence of God. Eli in the temple, in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 3. Eli the priest there. And we don't have to read because I know we're running out of time. If you want to find it, that's fine. But we find that Samuel lays down to sleep. And the word of God states in 1 Samuel 3:3, ere the lamp of the Lord went out. Somebody was slacking. That lamp was never to go out. It was there by the Ark of the Covenant. Fire represented the presence of God. We know that God was seen as a pillar of fire in the day by the Israelites as they journeyed, and a cloud at night. A cloud in day and fire by night. But somewhere along the line, people were slacking. Eli was slacking in his duties in maintaining the presence of God. The one who was responsible over everything was slacking. He did not see the preciousness of the presence of God. He failed to maintain the presence of God. And it went out. And if that wasn't enough, he did not view the presence of God as precious. He seen it as a means to an end, but he didn't view it as precious. The Philistines are upon us. Well, we better get the Ark of God out because we know if we get the Ark out, we'll win. The Philistines even knew. If they get the Ark, forget it. It's all over. Pack up your bags, go home, game's over. But they were careless with the presence of God. And despite what the outcome looked like, the Philistines still went full throttle. And they took the presence of God. Why did the Philistines take the Ark versus every other battle that was faced when they were taking the Holy Land? Because they were careless. They did not maintain it the way they were supposed to. It was a piece of furniture. It was a means to the end. It wasn't someone that we could have communion with. It wasn't someone that we were responsible for our sins. It wasn't God Almighty, but rather it was a means to an end. It was a way to accomplish something. And the light went out. The ark was gone. Not that the Philistines had a blast with the ark in the presence of God, because they didn't. But the Israelites were careless with the presence of God, and they lost it. Someone says this, okay, you don't want me here. I know somebody that wants me. They take him to the temple of Dagon. I don't want to be here. I don't want to be here with another god. God strikes down their image, tries to send them a message 3 times. They don't get it. So he strikes them with emeralds, and they force the Ark of the Covenant out of that place. So finally, it ends up into a house of Obadiah, a place where God, the presence of God, was practiced. And then finally, if it's not enough to have the man of God be careless with the presence of God, we find a prophet that was careless with the presence of God. In the book of Judges, we find the prophet Samson. We don't often look at him as a prophet because we all know him as Samson and Delilah. Place he went, he shouldn't have been. We find him as a strong, mighty man, but if we study now, Samson was a prophet. He was a man of God. He should have been a protector of the presence of God. But yet, Samson did whatever he wanted. In fact, we almost get that caveman mentality with Samson. Where, you know, he wants something, he just walks up and takes it. You have something he wants, he walks up, bumps you over the head, takes it. I want a woman from Timnath. Well, you shouldn't have one. Go get her for me anyhow. I want Delilah. Well, you shouldn't have it, but he goes down anyhow. We almost get that barbaric mentality. At least I do at this point in time. But he was a prophet of God. He was anointed to do God's work. But yet, he was careless with the presence of God. Did he know the presence of God? Absolutely. He felt it many times. I'm sure he felt it when he went in. Alan fought the Philistines. He felt the presence of God when he tied the tails of the foxes together with the fire attached to the tails. He felt the presence of God when he went out and slew the enemy with the jawbone of a donkey. But he was careless with the presence of God. And once again, like Eli, and even though he might have been sincere at one point in his life, though we don't see in Scripture, maybe he truly was sincere at one point. But what we see from Scripture is he was careless with the presence of God. He was anointed with God. He knew what it was to have the presence of God. But he did not practice the presence of God. And because of that, he did not really know when the presence of God left him. To me, that is one of the saddest verses in the entire Bible. He wist not of the presence of God depart from him. What does that tell me? That's somebody that did not practice the presence of God in their everyday life. That it slowly got to a point that maybe God was there when God wanted to move it. Samson was willing to be used. But there came a point where it was just, he didn't even recognize God anymore. And when he looked for God, he couldn't find him. Maybe in those times it slowly waned that when God came upon him to do something great, that God came upon him full force and he felt it. There was a difference. It's almost like you got a boost of steroids or something. I know, you know, I'm ready to go. I got it. And he expected the same thing when the Philistines came upon him with Goliath. But he didn't realize that God was far from him at that point. He left him. If we're not careful, that could be any one of us. We need to treat the God, presence of God as precious. How do we do that? We practice it in our everyday life, attempting to draw closer and closer to God. Because the closer we get with God, the more we'll feel Him, the more we'll recognize Him. And it might not be as strong all the time. It really won't. But it's one of those that when we call to God, go to meet God, that He comes rushing in. We go rushing to meet Him, and He comes rushing to meet us. versus the alternative that we go to meet him only when we need him, and all of a sudden he comes rushing in, but is in a strong way, and we don't really feel him throughout the day or in little ways. I'm reminded of John Frank Pye, a man who was not invited to camp meetings or conventions to preach, but he was invited to pray. And it's been said that one young boy wanted to go pray with him. So he allowed him to come with him during his time of prayer. And he had testified that as soon as he shut the door and started praying, that he was afraid to reach out his hand because there was a presence so strong in that room that he figured he was going to touch something physically. What is that? That was a man that knew what it was to practice the presence of God. What happens when we do not practice the presence of God? Then we find ourselves in a time of possible mourning. And when I think about mourning the presence of God, it's not that these men maybe didn't practice the presence of God, but they knew what it was that they lost. I go back to Duncan Campbell, where he testified where the men on Hebrides Island met in secret at night, and they would weep over what they lost. They were there and experienced the revival of God. They experienced the power and the presence of God. And maybe they still practice it in their everyday life, but it wasn't what it was. And for me, I don't know if it grieves me, but it concerns me or reaches my core to the end anyhow. That you realize that they used to celebrate the revival anniversary of Azusa Street every year. Even in the 90s. I think they still do today because I try to look it up because there was a gathering for Azusa Street in 2017. And you look at the celebrations of Azusa Street, and you see the platform just loaded with people. They know how to dress, you can tell they're church people. And there are even famous people that maybe some of us would recognize. Donnie McClurkin would go there and say, people that knew what it was to experience the presence of God. But do they really realize what happened at Azusa Street? Do they really realize what was lost? We go to celebrate what we once had, but we should really be weeping over what we lost. I can't help but wonder how William Seymour would respond to these annual conventions and annual meetings up for Azusa Street. If he's anything like me, he'd probably go behind each one of their heads and just start smacking them. You weren't there. You don't realize what we lost. We shouldn't be celebrating what God did, but we should be rather mourning what we lost and trying to get back to the place where the presence of God can come down and move in power, such a powerful way. You hear accounts about Azusa Street where the presence of God was so heavy that even babies didn't cry in the presence of God. It's just the power of God was so powerful there. Now, so many people, they celebrate the presence of God and such great things that happen when reality, we ourselves need to be striving to get more of God and mourning over what was lost and trying to get back to that point. We don't need to be celebrating the revival that happened in the past, but rather we need to be mourning revival that we don't have it here. We need to have a longing that, why don't we have it here? We go back, and I know you and I talk on a series on revival, but it's not a celebration of what happened at the first Great Awakening or the second Great Awakening. But we should be stirred to get back to the point where we feel the presence of God so strongly and see Him moving. Yes, we can see God move in our midst and we can feel His presence, but there comes a pouring out of His Spirit where even those that we haven't reached yet in the community just start coming to the church because the power of God is gone. We need to protect the presence of God. How do we protect it? By practicing it in our everyday life, by not hindering it, also making sure when we come to this place that it is a place where we make sure that we protect the presence of God in this place. No matter who comes in those back doors, because the devil will come in and he will try to hinder when something's moving. So for us, we need to protect the presence of God. And it all begins by us protecting it in our everyday life, by us practicing it in our everyday life. Anybody have any thoughts, any questions, anything they want to ask?
Better than two, light and fear. And he said, I'm a fear self example. And he said, only so much to protect as we need.
Absolutely. When we practice and we protect the presence of God in our life, there's power that comes with it. Anyone else? If not, if we stand.